Hello everyone, welcome to my next video, which is a continuation part of metal ligand bonding in transition metal complexes. As I mentioned above, the metal ligand bonding in case of transition metal complexes is explained or it is developed by three important theories, that is the VBT, CFT and MOT, that is molecular orbital theory. In this particular video, we shall discuss the postulates and limitations of VBT, that is the valence bond theory. And to begin with, we know that the valence bond theory is proposed by Linus Pauling. In 1885, he proposed the VBT, that is valence bond theory, in order to explain the metal ligand bonding in transition metal complexes. And in my last video, I've mentioned the hybridization or a metal ligand bonding in a case of transition metal complexes takes place, or the formation takes place obeying the postulates of VBT. So in this video, I'll include what are the postulates of VBT. The first postulates of VBT is the central metal ion in the complex makes an available and adequate number of empty orbital for the formation of a coordinate bonds for suitable ligand, and that is always equal to coordination number of the central metal ion. So number of ligand orbitals that can accommodate in the coordination sphere of a central metal ion, that purely depend on the coordination number. For example, if any metal ion is having a coordination number 4, then it can accommodate only the 4 ligands. And if the central metal ion have the coordination number 6, then it can accommodate 6 ligand, that is the octahedral complexes as such. And the next postulate is the appropriate atomic orbital of the central metal ion hybridized to give an equal number of new orbital of equal energy called hybrid orbitals. This is a definition of hybridization, that is the appropriate atomic orbitals of the central metal ion which is having an unequal energy undergo a special phenomenon called by the name hybridization to produce a new orbital having an equal energy, and that is called as a hybrid orbitals. That is called as the hybrid orbitals. And the next postulate says that d orbitals involved in the hybridization may be inner n minus 1d orbital, or it may be outer nd orbitals. Inner n minus 1d orbital, or it may be outer nd orbitals. Again, this depends on the strength of the ligand that is approaches. In my last video, I've mentioned at the end of my video saying that how the metal ligand bonding takes place in a case of transition metal complexes, that depends on the strength of the incoming ligand. Here also, sometimes the octahedral complexes may be n minus 1 d2 sp3. Sometimes it will be n sp3 d2, and this is purely because of the strength of the incoming ligand. If the ligand approaching the central metal ion is strong ligand, then it always leads to formation of a low spin complexes and inner complexes. If the approaching ligand is a weak ligand, then it is always leads to formation of a outer complexes and the high spin complexes. And now, what is high spin complexes and low spin complexes? The complexes which contains the nil number of unpaired electron are known as the low spin complexes, and the complexes which contains the maximum or unpaired electron, then those are called as the outer complexes. So the orbital sometimes involved in the hybridization may be either n minus 1d or maybe outer nd orbital. So if it is using outer nd complexes, then it leads to formation of outer complexes, and if it is using n minus 1d orbital, it leads to formation of a inner complexes. And the next postulate is each ligand must possess at least a orbital containing one lone pair of electron. That is ligand, we can call ligand when that atom must possess a pair of electron, at least a single pair of electron to donate to the central metal ion. And the last one is the empty hybrid orbital of a metal overlap with the fully filled orbital of ligand forming ligand metal coordinate bond. The empty hybrid orbital, this is one of the basic criteria in order to form a coordinate bond, because you know that here there is an interaction between the metal ion and ligand, but the metal is not going to donate a pair of electron. It is a ligand here donates a pair of electron to central metal ion. However, there will be a back donation, there will be a pi bonding by donation of metal ion to ligand. But in a simple way, if we say that there should be a vacant to the orbital which can accommodate or which can accept the pair of electron which is given by the ligand. So here comes the postulates, five different postulates of VPT. The postulates number one saying that about the coordination number, postulation number second saying about the hybridization, the third one is about the outer complexes and inner complexes, the fourth one saying about the nature of the ligand, and fifth one is the empty orbital overlaps with fully filled orbital to form a ligand, how exactly metal ligand bonding takes place. And this is about the five important postulates of the VBT. And next we shall discuss the limitations of VBT. So what are the limitations? As I mentioned above, as I mentioned earlier, the valence bond theory was first proposed, later the CFT and molecular orbital, because the valence bond theory failed to focus on some of the important properties of transition metal complexes which was needed to explain. So first limitation is, it has failed to explain the electronic spectra of the coordination compounds. So you know the electronic spectra. Electronic spectra is also called as visible spectra. Visible spectra or electronic spectra is exhibited by the transition elements. You know, visible is a low energy region where the radiations are absorbed by the electrons of central metal ion and get excited to higher energy state, and this was failed explained by the VBT, which is one of the important characteristic. And we know that most of the transition elements, they exhibit the color, and color is because of the presence of unpaired electron, and that was failed to explain by the VBT. The next one is, the theory gives no evidence to magnetic field generated by the orbital motion of electron. You know, the magnetic field is generated by it is exclusively by two important factors, that is orbital motion and spin motion, and this particular theory will not give you any evidence regarding the magnetic field which is generated by orbital motion. In my upcoming videos, I'll be dealing in detail with the orbital motion and spin motion, etc. And the third factor is, it failed to explain the geometry of the complex and the magnetic behavior. So there are some standards saying that the geometry and magnetic field, if the geometry is this, magnetic behavior, like it is paramagnetic, if it is a square planar, it may be diamagnetic. So this is quite misleading. Sometimes it may not be. So that important factor is failed to explain by the VBT, that is correlation between the geometry of the complex and magnetic behavior is sometimes misleading. And the last final important limitation is, it is satisfactorily doesn't explain why some complexes of a metal ion in a particular oxidation state are low spin, while some other complexes of the metal ion in the same oxidation state are high spin. For example, some metal ion may exhibit in the same oxidation state, it may be low spin, sometimes it may be high spin, and that is not explained satisfactorily by the VBT. And here I discuss the postulates and limitations of VBT, and in my upcoming videos I'll be in detail discussing with you about the CFT. Thank you.